I want to quickly show you three new CSS features that we're working on to help authors better maintain their overall CSS architecture. So first, we want to look at some of the pain points around specificity and selectors. Specificity is based on the assumption that generic selectors are also lower priority and more narrowly targeted selectors are higher priority. And this is a rough approximation of the layers in our code, but it's not perfect. And authors don't have much direct control. The act of layering is intertwined with the need to select elements. So Cascade Layers are designed to give authors more direct control over the layers that they need in the cascade. We can define a layer, give it a name, and add styles to it using either the @layer rule or by adding a layer function to imports or both. And layers stack in the order they were first defined, with unlayered styles at the bottom and the last layer defined at the top. Selectors inside the components layer here will take priority over the other layers. But we don't need to keep all our layered styles in that same order. The layer priority is based on when a layer name first appears. So we can even establish our desired layer order up front by using the layer rule without any styles, just a layer name or list of names. And once they're established, we can add to those layers in any order and our code will slot into place. We can also nest layers as needed and reference nested layers directly with a dot notation, or create anonymous layers that are maintained in a single location. This spec is currently a working draft and has become fairly stable. Both Firefox and Chromium already have prototypes behind flags, and there's already significant progress on the WebKit issue as well. The next feature is also about how selectors work. With scope, we're trying to address two problems that come up and often drive users to tools and naming conventions like CSS in JS or the BEM syntax. The first goal is to avoid naming conflicts as our projects grow, which we can solve by focusing on our second goal, which is expressing membership or ownership in our selectors. While nested selectors might seem like a way to express membership, in this case, a title that is inside of a post, that's not quite the same thing as a post title. The first one only describes a nested structure, but the second describes a more clear membership in a component pattern. Not all the titles in the post, but just the title of the post. Another way to think about this is to say that some components have lower boundaries. The component itself is a donut with a slot in the middle for content. And we should be able to style these donut components without worrying that we might accidentally style everything inside them by mistake. There are some similarities between scope and shadow DOM encapsulation, but shadow boundaries are defined in the DOM so that each element has a single scope and styles are strongly isolated from getting in or out. They're never allowed to overlap at all. Where scopes are defined entirely in CSS, they're more fluid, able to overlap, and integrate more smoothly with global design systems. So the current proposal uses an @scope rule, which accepts both a scope root selector, in this case media, and a lower boundary selector, in this case content. Any selectors inside the @rule only match elements that are between a matched root element and any lower boundary descendants. We're also considering how scope proximity might become part of the cascade. When two styles have the same specificity, we could give priority to the closer scope root before falling back to source order. There's also been talk about adding some form of selector syntax for describing lower boundaries to write more targeted selectors without the @rule or proximity weighting. This is still in very early design discussions, so we're happy to get any feedback. And that brings us to container queries, one of the most requested features over the last decade. While media queries allow us to respond to the size of the viewport, if we have those same elements in different sized containers, we can see that the viewport doesn't give us the information we want. So we want some way to reference the container itself and allow each of these cards to lay out differently based on the container that it's inside of. But this type of query could lead to infinite layout loops. So the first thing we need to do is define our containers, any element that we want to query, and turn off content-based sizing on those elements. We can do something similar with the contain property, but the current options are a little too heavy-handed for most use cases. We usually want to contain only the width or the inline dimension of an element and allow the height or block dimension to grow and shrink with the content. This isn't entirely solved yet, but we do have a prototype and we're confident that there's a path forward. But authors won't set that containment directly. Instead, we'll define the type of container that we want, what dimensions we hope to query, and then any element can query the container that it's in, its nearest ancestor that's been defined as a container. This container query looks exactly like a media query, but with @container instead of @media. And if you don't want to rely on the nearest container, you can also give containers names and only query ancestors with a specific container name, or only a specific container type. Chrome Canary already has a prototype and you can start using it behind a feature flag. Max Buck has created this bookstore demo with self-contained web components. Each host element is a container and everything inside the component adjusts based on the available size. We're also working on container relative units similar to VW, VH, VMin, VMax, but a percentage of the container rather than the viewport. So here's a demo by Scott Cullum where we can see that in action on the size of the type in each of these cells. And we're working on queries that aren't about the container size at all. The exact syntax is not established yet, but we might be able to query the value of a property or the current state of a container. Is it position sticky and currently in the stuck state? This is still an editor's draft while we work out the details of single-axis containment, but we hope to move to a first public working draft soon. All of these tools are designed to work well together and build on the existing features of CSS. We're really excited to see what people build with this and always open to your feedback.